I'm Ernie Bauer, back with you. Probably know me by now. Chair for Southeast Asian Studies here at CSIS. And it's an honor to chair our last panel, which has the very fortunate task of looking at habits of cooperation and confidence building in the South China Sea. We have a distinguished panel here today, and we will start with a distinguished expert from Indonesia, Ambassador Havas, Arif Havas, Oegroseno, who has come to join us from Europe, where he serves as the Ambassador of the Republic of Indonesia to the Kingdom of Belgium and Luxembourg, and importantly, to the European Union. But the Ambassador during his career has been involved in these habits of cooperation with a legal basis, and has a number of impressive successes in that area, and we'll look forward to hearing from you. Ambassador, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ernie, for the kind words. This afternoon, I would like to discuss about the habits of cooperations in Southeast Asia, but also the habits of respecting international law. I think that's a very important element that we have heard since the last 2 days. Now, the habits of cooperations, I believe, we can see from the clear witnesses demonstrated by the existence of a number of regional architecture and economic and political aspect. We have the ASEAN, of course, one of the most successful regional organizations in the world that plays a very important role in the regions. We have the APEC, we have the latest one, the plan to have a large regional comprehensive economic partnerships that involve nearly 3 billion people, bringing along ASEAN, Australia, New Zealand, China, Japan, Korea, and India. It shows that the dynamics of regional architectures are there. The habits of cooperations do exist in the regions. It has become one of the main anchor in the creation of peace and stability in our part of the world. But we also have habits of cooperation at sub-regional level that many of you may not aware of. I can give you two examples of sub-regional habits of cooperation. So first one is the arrangements that we have in the Straits of Malacca and Singapore. Many people do not realize that some parts of the water in the Straits of Malacca and Singapore have no maritime boundaries. They are not delimited. Some are delimited, some are not delimited yet. But the littoral states, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore, we manage to do a coordinated patrol to fight against piracy. There is a larger public goods, which is to fight against pirates in the Straits of Malacca and Singapore, that put us together an ability to deploy assets to fight them, regardless of the absence of maritime delimitations. This is very critical and very important because normally the Navy are not willing to cooperate if there is no very clear line of the allocation of the authority, but they do cooperate also. There is also a very interesting setup in the Straits of Malacca and Singapore, which is called the cooperative mechanism. This is a mechanism to work together in the safety of navigations. Again, this is a safety of navigation in a place where, in some parts, you do not have maritime boundaries. And in the cooperative mechanisms, we invite the user states, not only the littoral states, not only Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore, but we invite other countries. We invite China, we invite Japan, Korea, the United States, even Greece has a seat in this cooperative mechanism. So it's a very interesting setup that we have in the states of Singapore and Malaysia, again, to show that we can cooperate even in the absence of delimitations of maritime boundaries. Another example is the coral triangle initiative. It's a coral reef, a very big coral reef protections in the waters between Malaysia, the Philippines, Indonesia, PNG, Solomon Island, and East Timor. And many of these countries do not have maritime boundaries whatsoever. So again, it shows that even without maritime boundaries, we can actually do work together for a larger public goods interest. So I think these are important examples coming out of the regions. Now, we do also have, as I mentioned before, a habit of respecting international law. We do have disputes of sovereignty disputes, who owns the islands, for instance, dispute between the United States and the Netherlands in the early 1900s on one of the islands in the region, Las Palmas or Miangas. We have the case between Indonesia and Malaysia, Sibaran Ligitan, we went to the ICJ. You have a case between Malaysia and Singapore on Petra Branca, they went to the ICJ. You have the case between Thailand and Cambodia, again going to the ICJ. You have the reclamation case between Malaysia and Singapore, which were in the ITLOS. And there were a lot of cases in ITLOS on prom and releases issue of vessels. So again, you see a tremendous example of the respect of rule of law, international law in the regions. Now, Indonesia itself, on maritime boundaries, we have about 17 maritime boundaries. And other countries in the region, they do have lots of maritime boundaries as well. We started our negotiation in maritime boundaries all the way back since the 1960s. So we do have that deep entrenched culture of rule of law, of negotiations to achieve in maritime boundaries. Now, our latest maritime boundaries that we had is with the Philippines. We had a negotiation with the Philippines first in 1994, and we concluded in 2014. So it's a 20 years, it's a very long journey. But normally it is very long. Our boundary with Vietnam was first initiated in 1978, and it was concluded in 2003. So again, it was a very long process of negotiation. But the one that we have with the Philippines is very interesting because Indonesia and the Philippines are close partner, close friends in the negotiation in UNCLOS because we both are the large archipelagic countries in the world. Indonesia is the largest and the Philippines is number two largest in the world. We have a very strong bond, our diplomats, our lawyers, both countries, all the way since the 50s. And when we negotiate maritime boundaries with the Philippines has a problem coming from the treaty between the United States and Spain, the Treaty of Paris, 1898. That treaty provides a rectangular line that was considered by some to be the maritime boundaries line. Along our negotiation, we saw that as an issue, a challenge that we need to overcome. But I think the Philippines took a very great courage through the legal process internally to finally alter the line in the sense that Philippines finally said that, yes, they are going to abide by UNCLOS 1982. And then because of that, we are able to sign agreement with the Philippines. Now, the most important elements of these agreements are two. Number one, finally, Indonesia and the Philippines has a maritime boundaries. Second, a treaty, a line that is as old as 115 years old, still needs to be adjusted with the current international law of the sea, which is UNCLOS 1982. So that is the most important element. So if you have a projection of your line that is younger than 115 years old, so I would imagine it's much easier to be adjusted by UNCLOS. So this agreement creates a state practice, creates an example in international law that clearly unilateral projections of map, you know, cannot just be accepted just like that. So I think those are the important elements that came out just from recent habits of respect of international law. Now, I'd like to conclude with a couple of points. We understand that there are challenges going on in the region, in Southeast Asia, in South China Sea. But I think we need to continue the channel of communication from different parts of regional architectures. We need to have continuous dialogue and discussions in the context of ASEAN China, in the context of ASEAN of the East Asia Summit, in the context of the FTA discussions between ASEAN and the other countries in the RCEP. So those channels of communication, those architecture needs to be continued maintained because they could balance what happened, what we've seen lately. And I think, secondly, the working group on code of conduct, I think they've met recently in Bali. And I saw the report, it's very encouraging. And this working group needs to continue working. So hopefully at one point, we will be able to conclude all of the elements in the code of conduct. And lastly, I believe that these habits of cooperation, habits of CBM and respect of international law do exist, and they do need to be further maintained and further strengthened. So I close with that, and I hope that this session, Ernie, could also add to the dimensions of the debate on the South China Sea, that we should not lose our faith and hope. We still do have a number of ways to advance forward, and I think this is a very good initiative coming from CSIS. Thank you.
Thank you. That was absolutely uplifting, just what I was hoping for from this panel. Thank you, Ambassador. Our next panelist is Dr. James Manicom, and he is a research fellow from the Center for International Governance and Innovation in Waterloo, Canada. James, welcome down south.
Thanks, Ernie. I'll try to be as uplifting as the ambassador was, although I have to admit I've become more pessimistic than I'd like in the last couple of years. I think we've heard so far in the last panel that we heard the word mistrust and the word security dilemma. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you about a project we've started at CG that sort of takes issue with, I guess, the prevailing approach, the sort of default approach that we've got on CBMs in the region, which is that we need more CBMs. I suppose my thinking and the thinking of my colleagues, David Welch and Benoit Hardy-Chantran, is that we're not going to get much more confidence if we don't start building trust. And so we've started to think about how to build trust in the region instead of confidence. Particularly because, as the ambassador pointed out, there's a lot of good habits of cooperation within ASEAN, but the central problem in the South China Sea is habits of cooperation between ASEAN and ASEAN claimant states and China. And there has been some progress there on sort of what we call, you know, low-hanging fruit stuff, maritime pollution, that kind of thing, but we really haven't seen any binding codes of conduct or CBMs emerge, and we argue that's because of a fundamental lack of trust between China and the rival claimant states. And so we'd like to sort of, I'm trying to provoke you to think about ways to build trust. And we view the gap, specifically we view the gap between confidence on the one hand and trust on the other to be empathy. Empathy, we argue, is the bridge between confidence and trust. Empathy is, of course, very good for cooperation. As you cooperate more and more, you get positive iterated interactions, like Robert Axelrod talked about, and that in time builds more trust, makes future cooperation more easier. So I'll talk a little bit about empathy, about these concepts, and then I'll talk about what we call empathy gaps, so areas in where China and its claimant states do not share the worldview of the other. That's what empathy is, your ability not to agree with someone's worldview, but to understand their worldview. So we often hear about confidence, right? Confidence we think of as the subjective degree of certainty that you're safe from imminent conflict as a function of your situational constraints. All this, by the way, is laid out in my paper, which should be available on the CSIS site. If you want to build confidence, you do things like you engage in CBMs, right? CBMs improve transparency, provide advance warning, reduce likelihood of a crisis. We heard Mr. Fuchs out in a number of very promising sounding CBMs, which I argue aren't likely to take place because of lack of trust. Trust, by contrast, is a subjective degree of certainty that one can count on nonviolent interaction and peaceful dispute resolution with another actor, right? I am from Canada. We trust the United States most of the time. 80% of the time. That's the only allusion I'll make to a certain pipeline. Anyway, Most of the time. If you don't trust your neighbors, right, you lock your door at night, and you'll feel confident you'll be safe. But if you do trust your neighbors, you don't need to lock your door at night. That's the difference, right? And if you want to get to know your neighbors and develop sort of a we feeling with them, it's not going to happen overnight. Building trust takes time. But building trust can be greatly supported by empathy, right? By your capacity to understand their worldview, right? You can have confidence with an adversary, right? I can be confident that my adversary is not going to renege on his or her commitments if I believe that their commitments are in their self-interest, right? If adherence is in their self-interest, I have confidence they're not going to defect. But certainly if I trust them, they've perhaps stopped being my adversary, but if I trust them, then certainly our cooperation is far more resilient, right? Because they trust inherently includes a concern for my well-being on the part of my adversary, right? In the absence of empathy, I think what we've seen in Southeast Asia at least, and with China as well, is that countries, people, actors tend to overestimate one another's disposition for hostility and threat, right? This leads to a preoccupation with the security dilemma, posturing, pursuing zero-sum games, and ultimately, I think, takes away from a genuine interest in building confidence via CBMs, right? Every claimant, and I'm sorry to say this, every claimant has not followed the DOC as closely as they could have, right? We now hear justifications of deviation from the DOC and the fact that we didn't start this, we're just reacting to what others have done. Or you hear, well, you know, we're just trying we're just reacting to a change in the status quo. Perceptions of the status quo, I would argue, based on my own work in these channels, see perceptions of the status quo are very rarely shared between two actors. So this brings us to empathy gaps in the South China Sea. I'll talk about three groups. Empathy gaps, for another definition, we view as misperceptions or misunderstandings, mutual misperceptions or misunderstandings, of another's wants, fears, needs, desires, interests, judgments. And we can identify several. First of all, I think there's one between China and the rest of the world, arguably in the South China Sea, right? And that is that no one seems to believe the Chinese when they say that they honestly do believe the South China Sea is some part of their conception of what China is, right? My colleague Li Minzhang at RSI has talked about this all the time, right? From the time every Chinese person is in the second grade, they learn the South China Sea is Chinese. We learn the Arctic is Canadian in Canada. It's part of what you grow up with. China's claims, it argues, are deeply rooted in history. And what we hear more and more from Chinese colleagues is that the fact that these claims predate UNCLOS means that they should somehow be grandfathered in to international law, right? We heard that from the Chinese delegate at the Shangri-La Dialogue. I think we heard it today as well. In this view, China is justified in reacting assertively to provocations from others because it now has the capability to do so, and others are intruding on Chinese territory. We heard that from Professor Chu in the last panel. And this we're seeing off the coast of Vietnam, right? What's interesting is that no other claimant based its claims this way, and as a consequence, nobody shares the Chinese worldview with China's claim on the South China Sea. It's beyond just disagreeing with their claim, it's a worldview question. The second empathy gap, I think, relates to perceptions of historical experiences of other claimant states. It's curious to me that China justifies its claims in the South China Sea and its dogmatic line on sovereignty and territorial integrity as a function of its colonial past, you know, violations of sovereignty by great powers or colonial powers. But it's curious that China doesn't appreciate the fact that Vietnam and the Philippines have had these shared experiences. In fact, there were no unequal treaties for Vietnam. There was just outright, straightforward colonization, right? And likewise in the Philippines. And you hear the Vietnamese and Philippines leaders talk about this, right? State President Tsang said, we're determined to protect our territory and sea from violation. For every Vietnamese, national sovereignty is sacred and sacrosanct, right? So it must be curious for in Hanoi and Manila that Beijing frames its claims to national sovereignty in that way, but doesn't understand they've had arguably worse historical experiences than China has. And curiously, that has not manifested itself as rejection of Western legal concepts in either Vietnam or Manila any more than anywhere else. I think arguably the most important set of gaps for this conference relates to the United States and China. Right, the U.S., for instance, and this essentially relates to the rebalance, right? I mean, in the Chinese calculation, the rebalance is a justification for China to assert itself, whereas in the U.S. perception, the rebalance is entirely driven by Chinese behavior since 2008, 2009. You also, and you see this in the part of a number of publications that come out in both countries. I mean, a recent piece in Foreign Affairs argued that the onus is on China to improve the relations in maritime East Asia. From a Chinese perspective, obviously, if you feel you've been persecuted for the last, or the countries have been, you know, taking encroaching our territory for the last 30 years, that obviously betrays a lack of appreciation for Chinese perceptions, right? So what are the effective empathy gaps on international relations? Well, I think, as I mentioned before, the primary consequence is an overestimation of threat, which, of course, fuels the security dilemma and undermines the will to take CBM seriously. Right? Hotlines between the U.S. and China are notoriously underutilized. We heard yesterday that President Bush had to call Jiang Zemin 12 times in order to get him on the phone during the EP3 crisis. The creation of empathy, by contrast, can I think, yield a couple of good benefits. One is it keeps you from pursuing policy dead ends. In the Sino-Japanese case, the Japanese have figured out that the Chinese don't view CBMs as a pathway to improve political relations. They see it as a reward for improved political relations, which is the polar opposite to how Japan perceives CBMs, particularly around Senkaku Jiayu Islands, right? And as a consequence, I don't think Japan puts a lot of stock in pursuing CBMs with China around those islands. Another, I think, important advantage to building empathy is it can tell you a lot about restraint. How do you know what restraint is if you don't understand another country's worldview? For a long time, we heard from Chinese scholars and people who interpret China that China was being restrained by only deploying white-hulled vessels to Scarborough Shoal and elsewhere. That's a little bit like telling somebody that you've just slapped that you're lucky you didn't punch them in the face, right? That's not necessarily restraint from the Philippine perspective, right? So empathy allows you to tell you a great deal about how another country is going to perceive restraint. So before you can talk about what is restraint, you have to understand what another country is actually going to think restraint actually is. Empathy, importantly, and I'll wrap up soon, empathy is not a panacea, right? Empathy is not going to improve relations between two countries where there is a fundamental difference of objective, right? You couldn't build empathy with Hitler, but perhaps you could build empathy with Emperor Wilhelm, with Kaiser Wilhelm, right? Perhaps that was a German that needed a certain amount of recognition. Right, so empathy is not going to resolve fundamental differences of objective. And this brings us to the South China Sea. If the Chinese have decided that the South China Sea needs to be a Chinese lake, then really there's not much left to say about CBMs or cooperation or even empathy. At that stage, the question really is that in the U.S. interest? If it's not, what cost is the U.S. prepared to pay to prevent that from happening? But if the Chinese have, in fact, not decided that's the case, then there is still room, I think, for scholars and practitioners to think creatively about ways to build empathy as a pathway to trust between the U.S., China, and ASEAN claimants as a way forward in the South China Sea. I'll leave it there.
Thank you, James. And I promise that we'll get the word trust into the next agenda.
Thank you.
Very good point. I don't know how, but Professor Jerry Cohen has managed to get in the middle of this table every time he's been on a panel. So we will now recognize the principle of Cohen centrality at CSIS in our Southeast Asia program. Professor Cohen, as you know, you met him yesterday, is a senior expert on East Asian law. He was the director of East Asian Legal Studies at Harvard. He's currently at New York University. Jerry, the floor is yours.
My remarks today take off from what James has just concluded. What's at stake here, really, I think, is not trust or empathy. It's goals and strategy, as we've heard from Admiral Koda. But there's more here. There are two sides to the contemporary Chinese international relations, you might say personality or attitude. I went to China for the first time May 20th, 1972. A few weeks earlier, I'd given a lecture in Japan about the Senkaku Jiayu problem. About the third day I was in China, I was with my highly intelligent guide. We were on the hillside overlooking the gorgeous Valley of the 13 Tombs outside of Beijing. And I thought I knew this reasonable person well enough to raise the question of what did he think about the Diaoyu problem. And immediately he transformed into an ardent nationalist. China, he said, will never allow the hated Japanese aggressors to occupy one inch of our sacred soil. And he was getting apoplectic. And I nevertheless said to him, I should point out to you that 1 week ago, Japan did reoccupy and take over the administration of those islands. And then he changed again. And he said, well, there's a right time and a place for everything, he said. There's no rush. We can handle these questions reasonably anytime in the next 500 years. And I saw this mix of nationalism and Chinese pragmatic, practical outlook toward life. Now, talking about CBMs today, and I didn't want to talk about CBMs, I wanted to be on the panel for international law. And thanks to Odom's departure, I was able to do it. But the fact is, CBMs reminds me of my first faculty meeting, 1959. A very senior Austrian refugee professor gallantly took me to my first faculty meeting, and knowing my proclivities, he said, you know, now that you're here, you're going to want us to really take off and do things. And you're going to have a lot of ideas, he said. But my advice to you is keep quiet. He said, it's all been said before. And that's the way I feel about CBMs. We've been listening for many years to wonderful suggestions by people who affiliate with CSIS and with other organizations. I see my distinguished colleague David Dunoon from NYU in the audience. And in 1997, he published a stimulating article called Fair Division, A New Approach to the Spratly Islands Controversy. And he recites the Indonesian workshops and all the other attempts that had already been made to try to provide effective CBMs. Well, the moral is, of course, that if there's no will, there's no way. And the question is there a will, or should there be, or can we, as Cronin put it yesterday, and we heard also, of course, earlier today, about can we raise the cost to change the Chinese view? As I said yesterday, it's nonsense when you listen to a rigid statement like Xi Jinping made that China will not compromise over its sovereignty or territorial integrity. China, in many brilliant moves, has often compromised properly about territorial integrity and sovereignty. I recited yesterday the example of diplomatic relations with the United States without solving the question of Taiwan and arms shipment to Taiwan. That still rankles today, yet to be settled. I talked about the reintegration of Hong Kong into the motherland with this strange one country, two systems suspension, in effect of full sovereignty by China. Very special relationship, a very creative thing that got us over a very important crisis in the 1980s about the future of Hong Kong. I put aside the WTO example because that doesn't involve territorial sovereignty, etc. But what can one say about the 21 agreements made with Taiwan, the whole cross-strait progress? This was nothing if not a compromise, an imaginative, enlightened compromise by Beijing. So the question is there really a will? And here I must hand it to the CSIS people for undoubtedly arranging for the decision in the Bangladesh-India arbitration to be handed down just before our meeting here. Because here is a brilliant illustration of what Peter Dutton and many of us have been recommending. Confidence building can include a resort to the available international decision-making institutions that can make a contribution, if not ultimate solution, to many of these problems. It can be win-win, not 100% I lose and 100% you win. And here we have this vivid demonstration, and even better, we have this right-wing nationalist who all my friends in India fear, indeed hate, Mr. Modi, who comes out with just the right policy. Modi says, we want to improve our relations with Bangladesh and with Pakistan and other neighbors. And he has a foreign office that issues a statement that doesn't encourage the masses of India to run amok in protest against what's happened, but who says, well, this is a reasonable outcome we have to accept. And of course, we only get 20% of what we wanted, but we have to think of the possibilities this opens up for economic development and further cooperation in the area. You couldn't imagine a more enlightened foreign office statement. So I think the slogan in Beijing should become, let's learn from Modi, because we're always talking about India-China cooperation, et cetera, and the need of other countries to learn from China, which they frequently do. But I never thought I'd reach the day where I'm talking to people and say, Modi has set a very favorable precedent here in a democratic country where it's harder to control public opinion than in a dictatorial country where people are punished for speaking out. China has the ability to control its public opinion if there's a will to do that. I have a prepared statement, and I don't want to go into any more. I just want to mention one thing nobody has mentioned yet, as far as I can tell. The UN, we've talked somewhat about what are the current possibilities with respect to ASEAN taking a role. In reading David Danoon's paper of 17 years ago, I was impressed that ASEAN in the 80s and 90s seemed more lively to the problem we face today than it is today. But I want to talk just briefly about the UN. You'll notice that Vietnam recently, beginning in May, wrote several letters to the UN Secretary General, asking the Secretary General to disseminate to all the members the protests Vietnam has been making over the Paracels oil rig question. And China really was stimulated to make a response, a more detailed legal response than it had before. But can we look to the UN for CBMs? I don't think we're going to get much action now out of either the General Assembly or the Security Council. Vietnam knows China can control both. It's a political, not a legal forum where fairness and impartial decision-making will prevail. And I think China knows it may have more to lose by further ventilation of its situation before the world. But we shouldn't overlook the possibility of the UN. Well, I will just repeat what I said yesterday in concluding. If the new Chinese policy is to mix coercion with negotiation and exclude impartial decision making, I think we're in for a bad time. I think the other claimants and Japan and the United States can do a lot more than they have been doing to improve the climate through various measures, and I was happy to hear the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State be very specific today. But the real question is, will China maintain this strategic imperative for seizing and building on these islands for political, strategic, and diplomatic reasons? And I hope that this conference and other fora will try to persuade the Chinese leadership to think again that Deng Xiaoping was China's most brilliant international statesman. And Jiang Zemin wasn't bad. But what does Xi Jinping want to go down in history as being remembered for?
Thank you, Jerry. I'd like to introduce Dr. Alice Baugh. She is the director in the Department of Political Science and International Relations at the University of Delaware. Alice?
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ernie, and thank you, Murray, for all your efforts here at CSIS. I've appreciated the complex discussions of Southeast Asia that you guys have been able to provide. Let me begin by, my role here, by the way, is to speak about ASEAN. And so let me say that this is a difficult topic, not least because of the uptick in tensions in recent years, including events of this year, point to some serious challenges faced by ASEAN as an institution in managing these disputes and its very important relationship with China. In this sense, I think it's important that we be realistic about what ASEAN can do. This means being appreciative of the organization's constraints, certainly, but it also means being cognizant of the ways in which ASEAN and its processes continue to offer unique and important regional platforms from which to engage China. In my presentation, I want to make a number of points. One, I want to outline some of ASEAN's institutional and geostrategic limitations. Two, identify some areas under the ASEAN framework that might be further cultivated as opportunities for confidence building. Three, why it's important that the COC negotiations continue despite the challenges, as well as the very low expectations that many states have about it, especially given events of earlier this year. To be more specific, the point I'm going to make about the COC negotiations is that they are themselves a CBM process. Let me start with the first point, ASEAN's institutional and geostrategic limitations. I think we're all aware of that ASEAN's key challenge as an institution is that it is an organization of 10 different states. Many have elaborated on these differences, and so I won't belabor them here. I'll simply say that states differ, not just in the importance attached to the disputes, but also in their relations with China and the kinds of regional responses prioritized. And so clearly such differences challenge any collective position. In the case of the South China Sea, there are also important differences even among the claimant states. ASEAN's four claimant states vary significantly in terms of how they've approached the dispute. We hear a lot from the Philippines and Vietnam, not so much from Malaysia and Brunei, as was also highlighted earlier in the last panel. The larger point here is that until ASEAN's claimant states agree about how best to approach the disputes, it's difficult, of course, for ASEAN also to forge a common position. Now, this said, what they can work on, which is what they've been trying to do, is to work towards common approaches towards conflict management and laying out rules of a regional order. And a few developments drive ASEAN's greater interest and involvement in this dispute. While most ASEAN states recognize China as having legitimate security concerns and interests in the South China Sea, there is growing unease at what they see to be China's lack of self-restraint and intensification of activities in the South China Sea. Thus, one reason for ASEAN's higher profile role in the dispute in recent years is that the South China Sea disputes are now conceptualized as a larger challenge to regional order as opposed to simply a territorial dispute between states. A second reason that helps explain ASEAN's higher profile role these last few years is that it's more than a territorial, that more than territorial disputes are at stake. Far more than the 1990s, for example, ASEAN itself has much more to lose in terms of regional influence, and especially in the way of ASEAN centrality, which others have also mentioned yesterday. And this has become an important part of ASEAN's conceptualization of regional order, and also important to giving Southeast Asia's smaller powers, of course, important voice over regional trends. And so when we see, for example, you know, of course, the much publicized 2012 breakdown in terms of ASEAN's failure to produce a joint statement, we also saw, of course, a very quick action by Indonesia to produce a statement. It was late, but it was late by 1 week. And so those things are important in terms of the importance attached to the ASEAN process. Now, this said, the problem, of course, is that events of 2014 now challenge ASEAN once again and increase interest in non-ASEAN and less diplomatic solutions on the parts of some states. And I want to just give a little bit of attention to some at least one particular dynamic here. And that dynamic that I think has become a much more prominent part of the dispute is, of course, the United States. Here may be useful, I think, to highlight how the U.S. role represents an important disconnect, I think, between China and some ASEAN states, especially the most active claimants. Among some in China, for example, there's the view that ASEAN states have deliberately brought in the United States to force concessions from China. This unfortunately sits at odds with the view from some states in Southeast Asia. While some ASEAN states have been proactive in engaging the United States, there's growing consensus that events also compel them to turn to the United States for assistance. And here, I do want to kind of say something about, again, the events of earlier this year, and in particular, the placement of the oil rig in contested waters with Vietnam. Yesterday, we heard a lot of discussion about where that rig was placed. And here, I want to emphasize the timing. Because I think that that as regards ASEAN and its mechanisms, the critical issue here is again when it took place. The timing is no small matter because basically up until that point, there seemed to be some reason to believe that diplomatic processes, including the ongoing COC negotiations, were returning China-ASEAN relations to at least a less volatile place. So I think the timing of the rig is important in terms of at least generating questions about the ASEAN processes. I think the U.S. factor also ultimately raises different kinds of questions, however, as to ASEAN's influence and the role it's able to play in managing the disputes. The disconnect, you know, obviously represents some between China and the ASEAN states represents a political and strategic distrust, emotional gap, empathy gap, as James has highlighted. And I think, but it's also, of course, about a gap between the United States and China. And in particular, efforts to manage the South China Sea disputes are increasingly challenged by the intersection of major power strategic politics and tensions between the United States as a longtime status quo maritime power and self-identified maintainer of the maritime commons, and China growing a historically continental power interested in expanding its maritime reach and presence. And so why do I mention this? Because if we're going to talk about ASEAN's role, it obviously raises some questions about it to the extent that that relationship, the U.S.-China relationship, drives recent events. It does raise questions about the extent to which ASEAN, of course, can shape those developments, given what some have described as this U.S.-China maritime overlay that now hangs over this dispute. Ultimately, for the Southeast Asian states, I think that the U.S. role is a little bit two-edged. On the one hand, what it can serve to bolster the seriousness of Southeast Asian objections to China's extensive claims and activity. On the other hand, it introduces the very sensitive dynamics of U.S.-China relations to China-Southeast Asian relations that can complicate, of course, also a search for a modus vivendi on the issue. The two relationships often intersect, but they're also not exactly the same. In any case, this said, ASEAN continues to have an important role to play in keeping opportunities for cooperation open, and it looks like I'm really running out of time. So let me just say very quickly in terms of confidence building, a couple things. I do think that that there are some areas, and the ambassador has actually highlighted some. States have already expressed interest in terms of working together on various issues. Scholars, policymakers, analysts have talked about non-traditional security areas as areas for cooperation, areas that have already in which states have expressed interest. And these include, for example, existing mechanisms in place, as in the Malacca Strait, as the ambassador highlighted. There are existing information sharing networks. Those too can be expanded, and those are obviously at the sub-regional level, but those can also provide models for perhaps broader cooperation with other states. So maritime safety, I think, is an important area. Fishing. Fishing has just been such a provocateur or provocative area, I think, in terms of disputes. That might also be an area that might be further developed. Another area, I think, and I'm just going to say this very briefly, is defense diplomacy. Christian Lemaire mentioned this a little bit in the context of maritime security, and others have tried to update, basically, the term in terms of defense diplomacy. Yesterday, we also heard much discussion on the U.S. part as defense diplomacy is serving as a mechanism for reassurance towards its allies in building capacity capacity. And here I want to also maybe bring on the table the possibility that defense diplomacy might also provide an area for greater engagement with between ASEAN and China. And it may not be just ASEAN China, but also with other states. The important point is that China be included as opposed to excluded. So China should be included and engaged. And then lastly, let me just say that I think the ASEAN-China framework also continues to remain an important framework because it is a multiple issue institution, China-ASEAN as well as ASEAN itself. These are complex relationships. It is not just about the South China Sea. And so those frameworks provide a means to ensure that all the different issues come into play. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Allison. Just to clarify that on the timing of the oil rig, you mean that it was pulled out into those waters just a week before the ASEAN meeting? Is that correct?
Yeah.
Right. Thank you very much. Our next speaker, who has been quite patient, he's come all the way from Singapore. He's our last speaker in the conference. Last but certainly not least, Dr. Euan Graham is a senior fellow for the Maritime Security Program at the Rajaratnam School of International Studies, or RSIS, in Singapore. Euan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, CSIS, for inviting me here. As the last speaker of the conference, I realize that there's a double whammy challenge. One, to avoid saying what already has been said, and secondly, to try and provide some sort of uplifting note. Having said that, I think we are where we are, and I think it's fairly clear from the deliberations over the last couple of days, we have to admit that the habits of confidence building and cooperation have been damaged, if not broken, over the last 5 years. And that, I think, demands the basic challenge question. Given the topic we've been asked to speak to, whether in fact there are realistic or achievable confidence building measures that can be put into place to put Humpty Dumpty back together again. I agree entirely with what Jerome said before me, that if we go back to the 1990s, if we look at the amount of energy that went into Track 2, Track 1.5, the Jakarta workshops on the South China Sea were mentioned. A lot of that actually informed the declaration on a code of conduct in 2002. If we are at the situation where a lot of the confidence has been eroded and we're in a position of distrust and suspicion now, it's not for a lack of imagination or effort on the part of Track 2, or even for a lack of understanding about what needs to be done. I think it fundamentally does boil down to that question of a lack of political will, which then asks the sort of demands the question, where do you point the finger of blame? I don't want to get into that. I think it's pretty clear that China does deserve its fair share by dint of being simply a larger power than the other claimants. What China does will have a power and motivation read into it that other smaller claimants don't have. That's a kind of unfortunate asymmetry that comes with being a rising power. But I think there is a recognition that it's a broader trend, a negative trend, that across all of the active claimants, including China, Taiwan, Vietnam, Philippines, and Malaysia, that there has been a collective process of territorializing the South China Sea, which unfortunately has led us away from that injunction of the original 2002 declaration to pursue cooperation and confidence building, which was specifically in its mandate. And that, incidentally, for all its failings, is still the best that we have in terms of an existing confidence building measure for the whole of the South China Sea. So what hasn't been said? Well, I'll say a little bit. I didn't mention, you may have noticed, Brunei amongst the active claimants, because I think it's more of a nominal claimant in that it falls. There's one feature of the Spratlys that falls within its EEZ, but it hasn't done anything physically to enforce it. Nonetheless, the southern edge of that 9 or 10 dashed line does potentially put Brunei into a maritime dispute with China, and that gives it obviously equities at stake. Brunei is interesting. Why do I say that? Because it's a small state, it's non-threatening. I think it has a potential to play a niche role in terms of confidence building. And it has done so in a couple of ways. It had the unenviable task of trying to restore ASEAN after the tumultuous 2012 summit in Phnom Penh, which I think it did creditably. But beyond that, there is actually a live initiative through the ASEAN Defense Ministers meeting in which Brunei has the co-chair of the Maritime Security Experts Working Group, in which it's leading an initiative within ASEAN to put together cross-bracing connection of hotlines, or to use its preferred term, direct communications links between the defense ministers. And that has already been signed off at the first stage at the recent Defense Ministers Summit in Myanmar. Now, a hotline, of course, is only a tool. It's only as good as the ability of the people on both sides to pick up and to speak in earnest. So it's not a panacea for crisis management either. But I register it not just as a tool for crisis, but also, interestingly, I think, the silver lining of a lot of the tensions that we've seen between China and ASEAN is that the intra-ASEAN level, bilaterally, that's been the impetus, the spur to a lot of cross-bracing from a slow pace, but nonetheless, we are beginning to see the claimants themselves cooperating more. Don't forget, of course, that they have overlapping claims of their own, and that's been a sort of structural problem in getting that cooperation off the ground in the past. It's not only at that level of the Bruneian initiative. Vietnam has also, I think, been forward in leading bilateral Navy-to-Navy communications links, including some bilateral patrolling. And I think that bilateral level is actually where a lot of the real momentum is taking place. That's not to belittle the importance of the code of conduct and the multilateral process of engagement with China. But I think that has its place, and we've seen, frankly, in the way that a lot of the reclamation activity that's taking place in the South China Sea has actually torn a hole through large parts of the Declaration and the Code of Conduct. If we read down as far as paragraph 5, for example, it's pretty clear that you shouldn't be engaging the kind of activities that China has been, as was mentioned in Admiral Koda's talk. Let me also mention Taiwan, which hasn't received much attention so far as well. And there's a link here because Taiwan has also been engaging in its own enhancement of port facilities on its one single holding, Itu Abor or Taiping Island, within the Spratlys. And that, I think we ignore Taiwan at our peril. It's there, of course, in a rather peculiar form as a not recognized as a state by the other claimants, but nonetheless it has a mirror image claim to China. And that gives it a spoiler role. It's not party to the Declaration on the Code of Conduct, that there isn't the same level of restraint and the potential there for a kind of copycat precedent from engaging in that reconstruction activity, I think, is one negative. But it's not only a negative. I think Taiwan also maybe holds out some positive model to us as well. Why do I say that? Because I think Taiwan has a pragmatism in its ability to pursue interests-based access to marine resources that's actually set aside the question of sovereignty. We've seen that in the East China Sea with the way it pursued a fisheries agreement with Japan. Very nationalistic beginning, rather tense standoff involving maritime patrol ships with Japan, but then very quickly that's dissipated once Taiwan had got what it wanted. And we see also that although it's a rival claimant with several Southeast Asian countries, with the Philippines, too, there was a kind of trough in the relationship after the killing of a crew member by a Philippines Coast Guard vessel in 2013. After an apology was issued from the Philippines, very quickly that relationship went back on track and confidence has been restored to the level that I think a fisheries agreement and other forms of cooperation are also perfectly possible between the Philippines and Taiwan in future. Also, back to, I think, the Philippines and Vietnam are obviously the leads for the intra-ASEAN level of cooperation, because they are the frontline claimants who are feeling the pressure most directly from China, and therefore they have the greatest motivation to increase their own cooperation. We've seen that stepped up since the oil rig incident, that the Vietnamese Prime Minister very quickly was over to Manila. And there was talk there about increasing that level of cooperation, and clearly there's a shared interest there. Vietnam, this is the counterexample to confidence building. We should not forget that Vietnam, I think, over the last couple of years had gone to great lengths to improve the relationship with China, expanding the joint development zone in the Gulf of Tonkin, where for a number of years there had been joint patrols with the PLA Navy, and even regular communications. And that involved patrolling across the maritime boundary line. That's a significant level of confidence that's involved. Also, Vietnam and China had been able to establish their own hotlines at a variety of levels. They have the party-to-party channel that other ASEANs do not, between the defense ministries, and even between the agriculture ministries, because of the importance of fisheries incidents. But of course, in the acid test of a crisis, the call was made, but no reply came. And that, I think, shows the limitations to direct communications links. As I said, they're only a tool as good as the will of both sides to engage. But they're fairly low cost, and I think that for that reason, it's an initiative worth pursuing in the way that it cross braces between the various ASEANs, but also too, in future, I think it is important for symbolic purposes to get a recognition that there is a problem in that relationship. And I think realistically, that's how a lot of those hotline links were actually pursued by Vietnam with China. I realize I'm getting very close to the end of my time, so I will just conclude by saying that cooperation is happening at the intra-ASEAN level. I think the momentum is mainly at that bilateral level, and there is a clear inverse relationship with the lack of cooperation and trust between ASEAN and China. And I think that behooves us to realize that there's a need at the same time as trying to do what we can to improve the cooperation and confidence building and trust building measures. Nonetheless, that we are in a need to shift paradigms to crisis management from now on, in recognition of where we are. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much, Euan. Really, truly appreciate that. I wanted to ask the panel a first question, and particularly take advantage of the ambassador being with us. You know, is it fair to say that one of ASEAN's early successes was actually Indonesia? That Indonesia was the big country in the neighborhood who the other smaller countries were trying to understand what it wanted and what it wanted to be? And wouldn't you say ASEAN itself and its incorporation of Indonesia to be, it's obviously its biggest member, almost half the region by economy and by people, is that fair? Is that a fair statement? And is there any lessons that you could share with us from Indonesia's or ASEAN's success with Indonesia and Indonesia's arguable success with ASEAN that might be attributable to China, which is now the big boy in the neighborhood, and I think the rest of the neighbors are trying to convince it to play by the rules. And the second question for the panel is, what do you think China wants in ASEAN? Does it want a strong, unified ASEAN, or does it really want a weak and divided ASEAN? I'll throw that out to the panel.
Thank you, Ernie. I think Indonesia, I agree with you. We are the largest country in Southeast Asia, and I think it's very important for us that our behavior is not intimidating. It is very important for Indonesia, 240 million people, to realize that whatever small move that you make could send ripples. And that is why the government in 65, this is 66, we ended the confrontation with Malaysia. We also realized that although we are large and the biggest in ASEAN, our economic well-being cannot be realized if we do not have a regional resilience. We cannot have a prosperous Indonesia if there is a conflict between Indonesia and Malaysia, Indonesia and Singapore, or with our neighbors, because the waters that send goods, export, imports to Indonesia is also owned and controlled by those countries. And I think that is very important to realize that even Indonesia is the largest in ASEAN, we should be able to force a strong cooperation. It's not just a lip service, but it's something that we strongly believe in. And that is the reason also why Indonesia took the initiative in the 80s to mediate the conflict between Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos coming out of the Indochina War. And because of that, we achieved peace and stability in Indochina, and they became parts of ASEAN. It is because of that conviction also that we started the workshop on South China Sea in 1990. So I think the size does matter in many ways, and I think one of the ways that we have learned from our founding father is that we need to be also tolerant to our neighbors, that this size, if you make a wrong move, could send a very wrong messages. If you look at our history of maritime boundaries negotiations, younger generations, my generations, when they do a legal analysis of what we have with Malaysia, they would say, ah, you lose, because under normal negotiation, you would not negotiate with having this kind of boundary. But we have a larger interest. Our interest is not just winning a couple of hundred miles of waters or continental shelf. Our larger interest is peace and stability in the region. So I think that comes, I think, a very important lessons in the regions.
Yeah. Maybe someday a Chinese scholar will sit there and say exactly what you said. And on the question of ASEAN, China's view of ASEAN, would anyone like to take a swing at that?
I think it is in the Chinese interest to have a strong ASEAN. ASEAN will come into a single market coming up 2015. It's a very big market. It's a market with large middle class. Indonesia itself now has 90 million middle class and counting up, not to mention the Myanmar economy is opening up. So I believe China wants and have an interest of having a strong ASEAN of the economic perspective.
Thank you. Shariman? The gentleman here in the front row, please. Can he have a microphone? Are we down to one mic runner?
Thanks, Zeto. I just wanted a short comment. One of Malaysia's priorities for next year when it becomes chair of ASEAN is to introduce cooperation on search and rescue within the East Asia Summit. This is, of course, in the aftermath of the loss of MH370. The only problem I foresee with this is that, and also, you know, we were coordinating the search initially, and we were giving states, you know, even the United States, giving them very small boxes to look at in the South China Sea and all over the place, because some countries would take a dim view of if we were to extend the search area into their EEZs. So this territorialization of the EEZ going on that's preventing effective SAR. So I think it's a good idea that we're introducing that next year, but we really got to sort this issue of territorialization of EEZs that's preventing effective SAR.
Would anyone care to comment on that? Euan, go ahead.
Not so much to comment, but just to add on a little reference. I can't help doing so as I've been from Singapore, but it was mentioned earlier the problem of submarine operations and the lack of search and rescue capability amongst several of the new operators, including Vietnam and Indonesia, which is probably going to be buying new submarines. And Singapore has actually entered into bilateral agreements with both of those countries, which I think is quite a significant step into confidence building in a very sensitive area of military capability. So it's just to enhance that there is actually there's a good news story there if you dig for it.
That's a good point. Right here, up front.
Thank you. Hai Dang Vu from Vietnam's Association of Lawyers. I would like to have a question to Dr. James Manicom. When I was in Canada, I heard some voices that want Canada to re-engage in the region, in the Asia-Pacific. So can you comment on that? Do you think in the near future, Canada will have some role to play in the region? Thank you.
You mean you haven't noticed us yet? Oh, shoot, it's not working. I recently wrote an article in NBR's Asia Policy that talks about Canada's efforts in the region. I think people in Canada that study Asia are sensitive to the fact that our Asian friends miss us, and we like that. My government has fairly narrow interests in Asia that are mostly related to the economy, and that those interests are overwhelmingly China-focused. And our government is still divided on. Our government still has debates about China that America had about China in 1992. Human rights versus trade, as if you can't, pay lip service to one and trade the other way. But they'll figure that out eventually, I'm sure. So our Asia policy is very much a China policy. And those of us that do study Asia encourage our government to play a more proactive role in regional security issues. That's difficult because the way our government allocates funding for things like Track 2 has changed. They're now focused on things like deliverables, which has never been a strength of Track 2. So that's sort of limiting our ability to, as scholars, to engage on Track 2. At the Track 1 level, we did have a really big naval show of force, as much as we can have one of those planned for last year, but our supply ship caught fire, and that was the end of that. I do have to admit I was empathetic to the assessments yesterday of the Philippine Navy. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Carl Thayer, University of New South Wales. A brief comment and two questions. One, Alice, your remark about defense diplomacy, I'd like to point out, and Ewan's remark about the joint patrols between China and Navy. Yeah, the two Coast Guard ships, they've done their 16th joint patrol, then every alternate year they break off and do port visits. Well, they're now confronting each other in the South China Sea, and the Vietnamese media reports the Chinese are broadcasting the names of the Vietnamese that they met on these patrols. So you can have a switch from one to the other. But my questions are as follows. The Declaration on Conduct of Party outlines five confidence-building measures, but it's my understanding that one of them has not resulted in a working group, and that's on safety of navigation and communication at sea. Is that correct? And, it's been an often the guidelines from 2011 to 2014. We got 3 years without doing that. And two, more fundamentally, I ask all of you, and this is a religious question, what the heck are the relationships between confidence-building measures and actually addressing the problems that we face? I think they become an end in themselves, and I haven't seen any really satisfactory literature that if we do marine science exploration, no matter how important that is, that's going to get the Chinese out of Scarborough Shoal. So I just really raise that. I mean, in the beginning, when confidence and trust-building measures was proposed by Paul Dibb of Australia with CSCAP, and then they took the trust out, saying we couldn't distinguish between trust and confidence. Now we're back again to reinventing trust. So I'm taking a 40-year view of all this and pretty jaundiced, and I still hardline, how does a confidence-building measure, even if you do it, then really relate to the hard security issues that we're talking about? Thank you.
Ambassador, did you want to take the first question? Then I'll look for fingers on the second. So would you take the first on the...
Yeah, it's ongoing, the discussion on the working group. Possibility of establishing the working group on the CECOM and navigations. The discussion on the establishment of the working group on CECOM and navigation is ongoing.
Ernie, I can take this. I use the T word, so I suppose I'm responsible for this in some way. I take your point, and I share your pessimism. And the point of our project in my paper was to try to introduce the idea that if you can, everybody in the region, and this is difficult, everyone in the region, led by obviously their policy elites, needs to take a step back. And if they decide they in fact do want to get along in the region, begin to think about how they can live together, and that is involving with sharing their worldview, which I call empathy. To try to operationalize that a little bit, I think the U.S. government's actually done pretty well on this. If you read some of Kerry's remarks, you know, he once again reassures the Chinese that the United States is not trying to contain China, right? And it's patently obvious to anybody who's familiar with how hard that would be, that the United States is not trying to contain China. Chinese leaders could reciprocate, I think, by changing some of their language about how they refer to the United States in the abstract, right? I mean, China has welcomed U.S. as a Pacific power in the 2009-2011 bilateral statements. China could go further and drop the whole Cold War alliance nonsense, because they are a legacy of the Cold War, but guess what? They're still irrelevant because of Chinese behavior. So if China drops, I mean, that's a step that sort of speaks to U.S. speaking points, right? Those kinds of rhetorical sort of tits-for-tats exchanges, I think, are a very small step. The next challenge is trying to internalize that perspective on the part of the populations, and about that I'm very pessimistic, because that involves a sea change in how media in China and in the United States report regional events. And I suppose another way would be to identify areas, as Mr. Fuchs said this morning, where you'd like to see a restraint exercise and actually do it. So one example that is not a South China Sea example, the Chinese have been clear they don't like U.S. intelligence operations off their coast. I've argued in the recent article of Journal of Strategic Studies, that's a low-cost way, because ultimately the U.S., the way they gather intelligence is less reliant on those ships anyway, for them to back off. It speaks to Chinese preferences about restraint. You're showing to the Chinese, okay, we accept what you're doing, we're going to back off, maybe notify, do what Canada and the U.S. did in the Arctic, right? Don't ask permission, just tell them you're coming. It's low cost, and it actually does build a little bit of trust, if you like. But again, the only way to really internalize that stuff is to communicate it responsibly to your populations, and I'm not sure if any country is capable of doing that. That's the best I got.
Mike Masetic, PBS Online News Hour. To some extent, the ambassador has addressed this, but in all the discussion here, particularly Michael Fuchs's increasing reliance on ASEAN, I go back to a conference at which a senior Singapore academic was looking at ASEAN, somewhat in the TPP context, but nevertheless the same, and he saw this rising tide of nationalism combined with first Thailand in a shambles, the Indonesian presidential campaign, which really was nationalistic, to some extent the same in Malaysia. Maybe this is Professor Ba. To what extent does nationalism get in the way of common ASEAN efforts, whether dealing with China or anything else?
I'll just quickly answer that. I mean, I think obviously, as some of the other panelists, both yesterday as well as this morning, have highlighted, the domestic politics, you know, can't be ignored in any of the states. And so leaders, whether they are elected or not, actually, have to pay attention to their publics if they're going to stay in power. So I think, you know, to some extent, obviously, they complicate, I think, the search for a solution. I think some have mentioned already, I think some of Vietnam's constraints, for example, in terms of the popular reaction to China. I think that, you know, in terms of forging a common ASEAN position, you know, some of it is obviously reflected less by nationalism so much as, I think, different sets of economic interests, for one thing, that also play into that difficulty. They all have very different relations with China, and that's what it comes down to.
The gentleman back here.
Yeah, Kerry Gordon from National Defense University. I was just wondering whether global warming might play some role in the whole South China Sea situation. I think of two possible ways it might do so. One is rising seawater. I'm assuming that some of these rocks and other things that are sticking out of the water in some number of years will no longer be sticking out of the water. And so the question may become moot with some of those. Secondly, as we, I think most experts would agree, global warming is causing more disruptive weather patterns, storms, typhoons, etc. One could easily imagine a situation where some of these Chinese outposts far from its shores are going to require disaster assistance in the event of storms overtaking some of these structures that they're being built. You could have a sort of an odd, ironic situation where they, by force, have built structures and then need help from the closer states in the event of a serious typhoon, say. Thank you.
Ambassador, would you like to start?
Yeah, I think even without global warming, some of the features are already underwater. And with global warming, some of features that are now above high tide will could probably be underwater, but you still have some large islands, quite large islands that they're still in that area. So even if you go up, even a meter, you still have some, you know, big island in that area.
I think we need to be careful what you wish for. I mean, if some of this stuff goes underwater, we're talking about a 1 meter sea level rise, and that's, I mean, that'll change the face of a lot of Southeast Asia in a bad way. And associated, I mean, natural disasters, and I mean, there's a lot of low-lying coastal areas that border the South China Sea. So I don't wish for that.
Yeah, I think the rising tide of concrete will outpace climate change, unfortunately. So I'm not sure that that will provide the solution that you suggest. As for weather, there again, maybe weather provides actually a peculiar nature's gift of confidence building, and that once you've got inclement weather in the South China Sea and the East China Sea, it's the one thing that keeps the ships at port. And you do actually see a seasonality to the tension spikes in both during typhoon season. Nature is everyone's common enemy. And in that sense, I don't wish any repeat of super typhoons on the region. That obviously is going to increase the importance of humanitarian disaster relief. And that is, I think, although back to Carl's question, it's a low glass ceiling that is imposed on confidence building. But I think there is going to be an increased need for HADR, and that it may not solve the South China Sea issue, but it is, I think, an incumbent need on all of the countries to cooperate on more.
Let me just, if I can, I'll just add really quickly. I mean, I'll echo the comments just made in the sense that I think climate change affects actually more than, you know, the appearance of islands. I mean, I think there are also other economic interests at play, but I do think one of the questions here, also in terms of the South China Sea, is that despite, I think, the urgency that we feel, maybe it's not urgent enough, and that's obviously the same problem with climate change. These are very slow-moving developments. I do want to also address Carl's question so that it doesn't seem like I'm ignoring him. I mean, I also appreciate, you know, I think the question you raise in terms of the, I think the problems of confidence building. And I think, you know, you hear from this panel that there are questions about it, even though obviously we fall in different, on the spectrum in terms of, I guess, how much value we place on them. I think events raise questions about CBMs. They're fuzzy in concept. What is a CBM even? But I would also say that, you know, they don't solve problems, and as you say, hard security problems, but they might soften some of the, I guess, the more competitive dynamics that are associated with developments.
So trust basically creates an environment where you can solve problems, hopefully. On that note, I would say, you know, one thing we've learned in running this program and others is that staying on time keeps people coming back, including panelists who have traveled, you know, really from all over the world to be with us. And I want to thank all of you for your time and your thoughtfulness and your papers. I should mention that all the papers from this conference will be on the CSIS website and available, and they're all there from all 4 years of this conference, so it's starting to be quite a library and quite a research resource for those of you studying in the South China Sea. I'd also like to thank Murray and our team, Ben and Kathleen and Greg and Fong. They really worked hard on this conference for months, so thank you to our team for putting it together. And thank all of you for spending 2 days with us. It's just remarkable to see 400 people here, and I guess many hundreds who have followed online, I understand, and on Twitter. So thank you for your interest. I think this is really important, these discussions. We really do. I'd like to end on this panel, which I took away measured hope, and I do have confidence that we will be back together again in a year. So thank you very much for joining us, and thank you, panel.